Hi, everybody. Welcome to another episode of the Thrive and Survive Research Hub. I have my co-host here, Tineiwo Zenda. T, how are you on this fine Sunday morning?
Alex, morning. I'm very good. I'm very, very good, eh? And how are you doing?
No, beautiful. Fantastic. I feel very well rested. Had a great Saturday yesterday.
Yeah.
And I'm just excited for another great episode. So before this, we were talking on something. We said, hold up, let's save this for the podcast. So yeah. I'm going to throw it over to you and you can kick it off.
Okay, cool. So yeah, good morning to all the listeners and viewers out there. Thanks for tuning in once again to another great episode. So yeah, just a few minutes ago, myself and Alex were speaking about forward momentum or forward movement. And in discussing that, we also spoke about the fact that, you know, the fact that you're doing something doesn't always mean you're progressing. Sometimes doing something the wrong way actually takes you a couple of steps back.
Mm.
So to open up the discussion, Alex, I just wanted to ask you, what are your thoughts on that? And to put the question in layman's terms, let's get it out here. For you, obviously, with us acknowledging that direction is not progress, right? And momentum does not mean moving forward.
Mm.
What is your take on obviously starting something the best way without having to make the mistakes that take you backwards?
You know, I think that's such a great thing to touch on, because often I find people will set off on a task without really knowing what the outcome looks like.
Yeah.
So there's no intention. There's no like clarity and intention in the execution, which I think is a big, big, big mistake, because action, like you say, doesn't necessarily mean progress. And another thing that I take into account is you can't do everything at the same time. And I think this is a macro philosophy for life as well, in the sense that, you know, I like to say you can be and do anything, just not at the same time. So
100%.
Depends on the season of your life that you're in. You know, if you are, let's say you've got a newborn baby, which is a relevant one for you, it's probably not a good time for you to be worried about sleep quality and getting to term every day for this season of your life.
Yeah.
Because your priority is different. And it's the same with training and with work. You know, you need to think about, okay, in audit, we had this thing called busy season, which was a notoriously difficult time, because it's like post-year end for the company that you work at, and you're getting the financials ready. And especially on a listed client, you've got non-negotiable deadlines, because they have made public announcements.
Yes.
If you miss those deadlines, it's a humiliation across the board. So
and potentially your job.
Yeah. And it's just it's your reputation. And, you know, it's strange. I mean, not to segue too much from this, but I used to love the adrenaline of a deadline. I loved it. You know, you're in the trenches. It's like late nights.
Yeah.
Lazy. And you know what I liked about it? There's like a purity to the focus of it, because you just don't think about anything else. You just enter this like meditative Zen-like state where there's only the deadline.
Yeah.
And I don't know if that's necessarily the healthiest thing, but it's definitely the way to get results, in the sense of focus. So we were talking before this about high performance. And what I was saying is the best people I've ever worked with, they don't care about the volume of their input. They care about their output. So it's not, yesterday I worked 12 hours, give me a naughty badge, thank you very much. It's how much progress did I make towards this specific result?
Mm.
And to measure that progress, you have to know what the outcome looks like.
Yeah.
So I guess in a nutshell, it's having an alignment between the outcome you're working towards and the actions that you're doing right now in the present.
Yeah. Wow. And I like how you quoted that, especially the phrase that you use, the right time. you know, I can speak from a personal perspective around the right time, right? Because I think that alludes to the fact that life is not about making lots of right decisions. It's about making few right decisions.
Mm-hmm.
And then waiting for the results of the decisions that you've made to come mm-hmm. to life, you know?
Yeah.
And like if I, and that's why the term that says life is a marathon, not a sprint, right?
Yeah.
Because it's a very tactical, long journey. And like, I think there's nothing more tactical than running a marathon or doing anything that's got endurance to it.
Sure.
Because you need to firstly keep up with what is required of you now, not burn out.
Yeah.
But most importantly, also finish the race.
Yes.
You know, and it's the balance of those two that allows you to embark on the journey in the best and most optimum way possible.
Yeah.
So timing, I think timing when to do what is extremely critical. And I think that obviously allows for you to be results driven or deadline driven in a very healthy way, like you had previously mentioned.
Yeah. And also, you know, it's like intensity management is such a big part of running a marathon.
Yeah.
And I think a lot of people don't understand that because this will tie into the next thing I wanted to touch on, but it's like a lot of people will be impatient to get progress towards a result because they've been inconsistent.
Yeah.
And so they try and make up for a lack of consistency through unsustainable intensity.
Yeah.
And that's how they burn out. That's how you find somebody starts a new diet 2 weeks in, giving up.
Yeah.
Because they just can't do it. They're miserable. Yeah. They're depressed. They want to study a degree, but they start studying, you know, 2 days before the exam. And now I don't understand anything. It's so complicated. You know?
Yeah. And I like that the word that you touched on, the intensity management. I think that's something that the minority of society manages to kind of really master, you know?
Yes.
And I think this is one of the key differentiators between those who make it and those who don't, right? And just to comment on that intensity management, I think we see it a lot in life when people try to, well, people set a goal and then they don't manage the intensity of how hard they work towards that goal. Because I think at the end of it, I think 50% of a goal has got nothing to do with you. Your intensity is just half, or your effort is just half. There's other factors that are involved, such as timing, such as your environment, such as luck. There's all these other factors that contribute to it. And when a lot of us put effort into something, we feel that we deserve to get whatever it is we're trying to chase purely because of the amount of effort we put into it. But the reality is that the outcome will never be directly correlated to your efforts.
Yes.
There's a whole mix of conditions that are required in order for you to become highly successful.
Yeah, and I would add to that, the secret to the overnight success story is low intensity over a long period of time. Because
100.
Low intensity is not flash. It's not something that 100%. You put on Instagram. You know, no one's going to give you a round of applause for low intensity. But
100%. You
know, my favorite quotes by Tony Robbins is, people overestimate what they can do in a year and underestimate what they can do in a decade.
Yeah,
that's the thing, you know. And to tie it so well to that premise that you were making about luck, opportunities are a thing that is constantly coming in and out of our lives.
Mm-hmm.
And when you get lucky, it's when preparation and opportunity align, and it's like this friction that ignites, and then it creates this fire of success, right? So if you are constantly in the background, just working towards your outcome, you create the opportunity for luck to happen. Your probability of luck is so much higher because you're consistently putting that input there. If you're 100%. Only trying once every blue moon, the odds of you getting lucky is so rare because you're not creating those opportunities for luck.
100%. It goes back to the mix of conditions we spoke about earlier on.
Yeah,
Wow.
exactly.
And that now leads me to the next question that I have for you, right? Now that we're on the topic of success and obviously the prerequisites that need to be done in order for you to be successful, I want to discuss the correlation between being famous and being wealthy. So, a very interesting article I read the other day stated that there's no correlation between wealth and fame. And it went on to further say that more people who are actually popular are not successful. And that 85% of highly successful people are not known or unknown or unpopular.
Yeah,
So,
100%.
to get you right into my question, why is there no correlation between fame and fortune? Because, you know, growing up, you think cool pays.
Yeah,
But
of
then you
course.
become an adult and you realize cool does not pay. Can you maybe elaborate on why life is like that?
I love this. I'll tell you, I love this. And I think the reason is because success and wealth and a lot of things operate in alignment with certain principles and values and laws. You know, if you read the book The Richest Man in Babylon, which is one of my favorite books, it talks about the laws of gold, you know. And when you violate those laws, your wealth will disappear. So the thing about being famous is that I think being famous creates lots of opportunities to become wealthy. But if your character doesn't align with the laws of wealth, it doesn't matter how many opportunities you get, you will not be wealthy. And
100%.
like example that's on the side of this is look at how rare sustained generational wealth actually is. Because when you have this premise of the first generation makes it, the second generation spends it, and the third generation has nothing left. It's because the first generation operated by certain laws. And one of the most common failures of families that are wealthy is that they fail to teach the laws to the next generation. Maybe they try to, and the next generation is just not receptive. Like I say, it doesn't matter how many opportunities you have. It doesn't matter. I mean, look at lottery winners. How many of them go right back to where they were after getting a massive sum of money? Why?
100%.
Because they didn't change internally. Externally, things changed, but internally, they're the same broke person they were before that happened. And it's harsh to
100%.
say that, but it's true. So,
100%.
you know, it speaks to why it's also good to be patient on this journey of trying to become successful, because there's a process going on inside of you that you're not fully aware of, where you as a person are fundamentally changing. So I'll give you a great example. It's not about money, but it's about getting into shape. So if you want to be, say you're somebody who's out of shape, you're fat, you don't exercise, and you want to become somebody who's, you know, aesthetically pleasing, and you take steroids, your progression from your base to your goal will be quite rapid because steroids is performance enhancing. The problem is you cannot use that compound permanently. It will destroy you. So you cheat the process and you get the outcome, but your internal self has not changed. Your choices that you make every day is the same. So what happens? Because your actions haven't truly changed, you go right back to where you were. So that's the thing about fame. You know, fame creates opportunities for wealth, but if the person who is famous doesn't change their behavior, they won't be wealthy. And like a great example of
100%.
this is look at, I think it's Floyd Mayweather and 50 Cent are two good examples of this. They are two guys who are very good at what they do, but not necessarily good at managing their money. The money comes in big lump sums rapidly because of their success in their chosen profession, but they don't make good choices. And so the wealth disappears. And the thing is, they have the mentality of, well, it's easy for me to make these opportunities because I'm famous and I'm talented. So I don't have to worry too much about applying these laws because they don't apply to me. They apply to non-famous people, you know? And the thing is about these laws is they don't care if you're famous or not. You can be the most around the world, but if you don't follow them.
Shucks, bro. And I mean, that just speaks to like, I mean, how many famous people do we know of, from musicians to sports stars to
broke
actors?
Broke.
You know, people who made millions of dollars. You know,
exactly.
I mean, I think a prime example, someone who I love so much, Mike Tyson.
Yeah, same. I love him. But 100%.
You know, and to touch on that whole fame and fortune thing, you know, like to quantify it, you know, we all know the Pareto principle, the 80-20 rule applies across everything, right? Then,
yes.
Like I was chatting to my wife the other day, and she was like, she always says, cool does not pay, firstly. Because what does cool mean? Cool basically means that you are approved by 80% of the population.
That's a great way of putting it. Wow.
Right. And 80% of the population generally thinks the same and generally is not right. 80% of the population are also generally average.
Yeah.
So cool should not be a concern for you, because if you are approved by the 20% who are the game changers or the future leaders or the thought leaders, then you're more likely to be successful. And that's why cool does not pay. So I think that attention that comes with being cool or being approved by the majority can only be handled by extreme humility, conscious humility. And I think someone who's done that really well over the most recent weeks has been like Siya Kolisi.
Yes.
Or Nelson Mandela or Mahatma Gandhi, right? Because
a guy like Ryan Reynolds.
Underrated.
And I'll tell you why. Because he's a fantastic entrepreneur in his own right. And his biggest fan is his wife and his kids.
Yeah.
Which is high praise. Because it's one thing for people to love you for the character you play on a TV screen, but it's another thing for people to love you for your real character. Behind the scenes.
And you used a really good word there, high praise.
Yes.
Right? That's quality praise. You want to get quality praise.
100%.
You don't want to get a volume of low quality praise.
Yep.
So at the end of the day, that's where your energy comes from, right? So I'm glad you clarified that topic. But you know, I always just find it so flabbergasting. Even like sometimes when I'm in Cape Town, I go to Cape Town quite often. I think to myself, like 95% of this whole Clifton Mountain is owned by unknowns.
Yeah. Yeah, exactly. And I mean, Naval, he has a great quote where he says, "You want to be rich and anonymous, not famous and poor."
Yes.
Which is exactly correct, because you know, when you're famous and poor, you've got all the downsides of being famous, but none of the perks.
Yeah, and you have to hide, right? Like I've seen it a lot of times, where people are famous, so they put up a facade of who they are and what they have. And in instances where now they really need to showcase what they've put up, they're not able to, right? And then they hide, and they, you know, there's a whole set of consequences that come up with putting up a facade, a fake version of
yourself. 100%. There's a great movie. I watched the movie with my parents last night called Catch Me If You Can. Have you heard of this movie?
Okay. Uh-uh.
So it's based off a true story about a gentleman called Frank Abagnale in America, who was basically like a con artist, but in a very interesting way. Because so he was about 16, ran away from home because his parents were getting divorced, and he made money by performing check fraud. So he falsified checks.
Yeah.
In the beginning. And then he pretended to be a pilot. So he pretended to be a pilot. He flew for like 200 flights where he wasn't a real pilot. He learned it through modeling the behavioral patterns of the pilots that he studied. And through his ability to con and influencing people, which he was unparalleled with. And then the next thing he did was he pretended to be a doctor. Same story. And then lastly, he pretended to be an attorney, and he actually passed the bar exam without a degree or anything. So he was a very clever guy, and eventually he got caught. But the reason I bring up the story is because in the beginning, you see, because he influences people, he gets a lot of attention, and you know, he sleeps with beautiful women, he's making quick money, he's got lots of friends around, and all of these things is true. Up until the point he gets engaged with this lovely girl who's got a very prominent father. But the whole time, no one knows who he really is. And he can't let them know who he really is. And multiple points of this film, I'm sure they added it for dramatic effect, but you see he's trying to tell people, this is not really who I am. This is who I am. And the people who knew the real Frank Abagnale, he had no relationship with his parents and his siblings. So how empty the life is when you get this cheap praise, like you said, cheap praise from people who don't know who you are because you're playing.
Yeah.
That is the loneliest person in the world because you're surrounded by people and they don't know who you are. You know, you can have 100%. One person with you, but they know you fully and you will never feel
100%. Shucks. You've said that so well. And I mean, I think that's why, like, obviously, I mean, it's hard to speak of what someone else is going through if you're not in their shoes, right?
Sure.
But I think the objective analysis of it, based on the facts that we've mentioned, clearly tell us that, you know, being yourself is the first step to freedom, bro. And being yourself also allows for you to be happier. It also guarantees you a higher chance of success, right?
Yeah.
I understand there's this saying, fake it till you make it. But the fake it till you make it has a big requirement of you being yourself while you fake it, right?
100%. I think that's a completely misconstrued phrase. Because I think fake it when you make it actually just means step outside of your comfort zone until you become comfortable. Yeah.
100%.
That's actually what they're 100%. Trying to say. But people are more like pretend to be somebody that you want to be, that you're not. Like,
100%. Yeah, yeah. And I mean, even to make it even more concise, for me, fake it till you make it doesn't mean pretend to be someone else.
Mm.
It basically means be the future you.
Yes, dude. Oh, yes. And this actually, I'm going to jump ahead to one of the things I wanted to touch on because this applies to that. Okay.
Perfect.
So I wanted to talk to you about the relationship between adding value and the rewards of adding that value. Okay. And the reason why I bring this up is because everybody wants to get a promotion at work. Everyone wants to get paid more. Everyone wants more friends. Everyone wants that pretty girl. Everyone wants the fruits of labor that they have not done yet. Right. And there's this principle of, if you want to be a wealthy man, you must become a wealthy man first.
Yeah.
And what that means is, if you want the output, you need to be doing the inputs internally. So in the 7 Habits of Highly Effective People, they speak about this and they really do it, such an eloquent job of explaining it. It's called the inside out approach.
Okay.
Inside out approach. So it means to get external success, you need the private victories first of changing your fundamental character. So in the 7 Habits, they break down the book into 2 areas, private victories and public victories. The private victories are the choices you make when you're by yourself, no one is watching, no one's judging you, there's no external discipline. It's the little internal disciplines you do every day. That's the work. That's the private victories. So the first 3 habits are be proactive, begin with the end in mind, and there's a 3rd one that I can't think of right now. And then what you do is you focus on those habits because it changes your character as a person.
Yeah. Yeah.
And then the last 4 habits are all outward, like people focused. So seek first to understand, then to be understood, think win-win, et cetera, et cetera. And it's a beautiful concept of this thing of focus on being the thing first before you want to get the thing. Mm-hmm. It's like for us, we're doing a podcast and it's like, you know, everyone wants to be on a similar level of success as Joe Rogan. Mm-hmm. But Joe Rogan has done 2,000 episodes. Over 10 years.
Yeah. Exactly.
So if you want to get that, you've got to be that.
Yeah, 100%.
You know,
and I think
it's Sia Khaleesi, but no one wants to have the life that Sia Khaleesi had leading up to that.
Yo, my man, that's not for the faint heart today. What he went through, that's a 90% or nine. I've seen 99% of people who go what he went through end up on the streets, high on drugs.
Blessings, but they don't want the burdens that come with the blessings.
Yeah. And I mean, I like what you particularly mentioned there around, you know, everyone wants to win, you know, but like no one wants to take the decisions that allow for you to win.
Yeah.
And to rewind it back to what we were speaking about earlier, when you want to make all these decisions and put everything into action.
Yeah. Right?
And then expect a promotion tomorrow. But the reality is that, you know, those who get promoted and those who, to be quite frank, don't always work the hardest. You know?
Sure.
These are people who I mean, I'll use myself as an example, right? Like someone who knows me at face value probably thinks this guy's just coasting. You know, like works from home, travels half the time, always playing golf.
Sure.
But the reality is that the most time I invested was in my plan. Right.
Yeah.
And the tactical steps that I'm going to take to execute this overall strategy that I've put into place. And now it's a matter of timing and making the decisions at the right time.
100%.
So the hard work is done. The hard work is in the plan. And now it's just about the low intensity consistently and then identifying pivotal moments to make big decisions.
Exactly. And that's
and those big
consistency
are what people see. Yeah. And those big decisions are what people see. And those big decisions get you recognition. Not your hard work, not your amazing presentations, not your plan, but the tactical steps and the big decisions you made within your plan in order for your results to come to fruition.
Well, those were your private victories. You know, that's the thing. So people see your public victories and then they're like, oh, this is so unfair.
But yeah.
Private victories. And this is my thing. It's like, people want 10 years of results or for 1 year of effort.
Yeah.
You can't cheat the process. You can
100%.
You can optimize the, you know, the how do you say efficiency of the journey by making intelligent choices, 100%. But you can't cheat the process. And that's my thing. And that's where people will say overnight success. This is an overnight success because they just see the public victory. And they weren't paying attention the whole time. And this is the thing as well. It's like you can make, you know, familiarity breeds contempt, right? It's
a
great quote. And what it means is like, if I spoke to somebody who's known me since I was a child and I gave them the secret to the universe, they would laugh at me and discard it to the side. But if I were to reach a certain level of prominence, and I were to say the same exact thing to them, they would look at me as if I'm a genius because now what I'm saying has this weight of credibility behind it.
Yeah.
But the answers are the same. 2 + 2 = 4.
100%.
Sounds revolutionary when you're a genius. And everyone's looking for the secret. And no one wants to listen to the truth.
Yeah,
and
sure.
And you know this as well as I do. Like how many times have people asked you for advice and left... They've left that conversation feeling completely underwhelmed and dissatisfied.
Yeah.
Because
told
them something they already know, but they don't want to do.
Yeah. Yeah. Because like you said, everyone's looking for the easiest routes, right?
Yeah, there needs to be code. It needs to be
a
code, you know?
Yeah. And there's no, unfortunately, I mean, there's no, even like having a debate with all my colleagues. I think the difficulty of inheriting and the difficulty of making money is exactly the same. Because when you inherit, you're by default weaker mentally, physically, everything. Like I can tell you now, bro, a hobo can take more punches in the face, unfit, untrained, than someone who's grown up well and gymming for the last 10 years in boxing.
A great example of this is there's an MMA fighter by the name of Tony Ferguson who is getting trained by David Goggins in the last week. They just did a hell week.
Okay.
Goggins wiped the floor with this professional MMA fighter. Goggins is older than him, but the stuff that they were doing, Goggins destroyed him.
Yeah.
Right? Because he permanently subjects himself to hardship. He didn't have a coach teach him these things. He did it to himself.
Yeah.
And this Tony Ferguson, who's a legend in his own right.
Yeah.
He's a tough guy, of course, but it's always been external coaches, environments, programs, training for fights, 100%. Training for the Goggins trains for himself, you know.
100%. And I like how you said that, right? He put himself through that to condition him and to go back to the point I was alluding to around inheriting and it's the same difficulty because the condition of the person is in alignment to that. And that's why it's hard to keep wealth, it's so hard to make wealth.
Yes.
And those who have wealth inherited are just at danger of that exact wealth as the one who doesn't have it and is fighting poverty. A lot of people debate, you know, and like my dad always says to me, like he always says to me, like, and even though I see it now that I'm, you know, in a bit of a higher senior management position, always says, sit in a room. When I sit in a room with other young professionals, irregardless of race, everyone who's sitting with me in that expo room is coming from a very tough background.
Mm.
It's very seldom where the same boardroom I'm sitting in, I have a boy who went for private school sitting with me. And I can use myself as a good example.
Yeah.
The other guys on my level had to get scholarships to go to school. Some of them are coming from the townships. Yeah. Some of them are coming from families where both mom and dad died.
Yes.
You know? And the most dangerous person or the person who is going to be alongside you one day, maybe right now sitting in a shack, studying off a candle, not having a calculator to write math exams.
Yeah, 100%. You know, the thing is, the difference, I would say, is so the output is character and wisdom, but the inputs are different because when you come from hardship, the input is circumstantial and you don't have a choice.
Yeah.
When you come from comfort, the input is all internal. It's all internal because there's no external push. It's like the difference between being in the military and having a drill sergeant that wakes you up every morning and being at home in ordinary society and being your own drill sergeant.
Yeah.
And I'm not, you can't make, a person shouldn't make a value judgment because again, the outcome that you're working towards is the same. But having an external enemy versus having an internal enemy. Your external enemy is not always there. Your internal enemy is always there.
Yeah.
And he 100%. Knows your weaknesses. He knows exactly what to do to destroy you.
Yeah. Yeah.
And you always have to keep him at bay, you know?
Sure. I think that's a very nice way to like wrap up this. I don't think there's any stronger way to end this, but from what I'm getting there, it's basically tame your ego, put it on a chain, right? Because once you lose control of that, you become your own worst enemy, and the worst enemy you can ever have is the one inside of you.
That's 100%. That's 100%. And I think when we go, I want to just leave the people with a quote from this week that served me well. It's by Seneca, who was a Stoic philosopher, and he said, "A man who suffers before it is necessary suffers more than necessary." And what well that said. Means, if you guys don't know, is don't fret over imaginary circumstances and pains and hardships that might not even happen. And even if they do happen, might not be as bad as you think they will be. You know, it's like they say, a coward dies many deaths, but a brave man dies once. Same principle. So live in the moment, you know, be present. Don't worry too much about the future. Focus on the controllables. And what happens, happens.
So true. Wow. And well said. Like I said, there's no stronger way to finish this this episode. And I'm gonna write that quote down. Very, very enlightening.
Thank you. Thank you very much for this episode, brother. It's always a pleasure. Everybody, thank you so much for listening to us on this fine Sunday. I hope you got a nugget of wisdom that can serve you in your life. Lots of good episodes coming up in the future. And yeah, until we speak again.
Julio, cheers, guys. Cheers, Alex. Thanks for your wisdom.